Hey everybody, welcome to another virtual CrossWalk worship experience. I hope this finds you well. If you're feeling really shaky and anxious right now, you are not alone. A lot of people right now are feeling the tension in the air because of so many things. Certainly the political climate and what's been happening in our country has caused extra concern on top of so many other things. So thank you for tuning in today. This is a good part of your mental and emotional and spiritual health, and I hope today helps you. What we have for you today is a couple different things. First is we have a song that does two things for us. It provides a space to kind of breathe and center ourselves into this service. And also, it is a nod to what Monday's holiday is, which is Martin Luther King Day here in the United States. And so this is a song by my favorite band, U2, called MLK. Many of you have probably never heard this song. It's not one that U2, true U2 fans would certainly know it, but it's not often done at concerts and never on the airwaves. But it's a nod to MLK. And after that song, I'm going to lead you through the Lord's Prayer as an aspirational prayer. Sometimes, in fact, very regularly, I tack on the Lord's Prayer to the end of a teaching as a way to affirm, you know, the things that we just heard. And it's sort of a way of saying yes in our own way in response with this prayer that Jesus created. But this time, I think in terms of MLK, we need to make it more of an aspirational thing, particularly in light of what's been happening in our country when we see extreme hate groups rising up and violently wanting to take us back to where we don't want to be. Our country is in flux, and it always has been. There was this phrase that I'm reminded of as I've been listening to some history of our country. And the phrase is, things aren't as good as they used to be, and they never were. The truth is, our country has always been in flux, and it's always been messy as we go through our own journey, our own process of becoming as a nation, and in the global environment, as things change around that. This is the way it always is. The hopeful thing is we are moving forward. There are things that are better than they were. And yet we still have a long way to go, particularly on this front of how we see ourselves and how we see other people as truly equal among us. And that is going to be an ongoing challenge. MLK, Martin Luther King Jr., certainly knew that there were systemic issues at play that kept African Americans in particular, but all people of color in general, at a disadvantage compared to white culture, which is me. And if you challenge that or wonder about that, because I know, you know, depending on what news station you listen to, you may not even believe that there's such a thing as systemic racism. And so if that's kind of where you are, I want to invite you to get out a piece of paper at some point and just scratch down, if systemic racism exists, how would you know that it did? What would be the indicators? What would be the symptoms of such a thing? Because my hunch is when we just kind of keep it at arm's length and say, well, I'm not racist, so it's not my problem, and I don't think we're a racist country because it says in our Constitution we're not, all that stuff. Sometimes I think if we just back up and start asking ourselves those questions in a very thoughtful way, we're able to see what we believe, and then, you know, it gives us something to look for. You know, are these things at play? I think they are, in very pronounced ways, and they definitely have historical roots in our country. We have had moments of moving forward right after the Emancipation Proclamation. For about 15, 20 years, it was pretty, I mean, some amazing things were happening in our country for African Americans. And then there were some deals made that completely eradicated the Reconstruction of the South and opened the door to a new form of slavery called Jim Crow. When that happened, among some other things that were happening on a constitutional level for our United States, things just went south in a hurry. Certainly for African Americans and people of color, but also for women. It was a major step back in a part of our country's history before we leapt forward again. So we're seeing ourselves as we are, and that's helpful because once we see ourselves as we are able to address those things that need to be healed and fixed. And it's going to be a long, slow process, but being aware that we got a problem is a first step. After the meditation and the Lord's Prayer, then we jump back into the forgiveness series, and I got a song for you. I think you're going to like it. It should warm you up to the whole idea of forgiveness. And then we continue the featured guests that we're offering throughout this forgiveness series to give us our third segment of that series, and then you're off. If you want to do some follow-up work with the teaching stuff, go to crosswalknapa.org, look under teachings, and in the blog post for that, you will see some reminders of the teaching and some questions to process to help you take it deeper. You're always welcome to join me at Praxis at noon on Wednesdays as well as 7 p.m. Not this week, however, because of the inauguration. I want to be present for that, and I encourage you to be present for that, pray for that. That things are peaceful and smooth, as we certainly hope they will be. And so no Praxis this week, but next week we'll get that going. Okay, thank you again for tuning in. Take a deep breath, center in. The Spirit of God is at work today, and we will embrace that together. See you in a bit. So as I mentioned today, I want to invite you to say the Lord's Prayer as a prayer of aspiration. The truth is that our deepest, greatest dreams are rooted in God, in the Spirit of God. And our greatest dreams and aspirations for our nation are rooted in God. Because God is the source of love, God is the source of life. God is the source of harmony, of shalom that we've talked about so much. And so when we pray that prayer, it is our intent to say to God, We want more of what you have to offer in your healing and your wholeness and your peace and your love and your joy, all those wonderful things. We want more of that. And I would even go so far to encourage you to, as you pray this, not just pray it for yourself, but imagine the people that you love as you're praying this prayer and your community, your bubble. I would encourage you to even extend it beyond that, that your aspirational prayer for this is even for those people who wish this country harm and who you may look at as not worthy of grace because this prayer is a help to them too. In all of the best, most beautiful, healing, hopeful ways. So, won't you pray it with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Forgive you. there, friends, and here we are at session three. You'll notice a growing collection of cups on our coffee table. This is the marker of our process this day, and we're having a good time being together. Just carrying over from the last session where Barbara introduced that really helpful triangle. I was really appreciative of that, of reason, feeling, and will. And so it led me to hope that, in fact, the feelings that you have are of delight being together in community. I sure appreciate the intellect that got you to this session, wherever you are this evening or whatever time of day it is for you. And of course, the will that helps us or that leads us to engage with these really important human matters around our relationship with the divine, with all that is. And so I'm intrigued by Barbara's topic in this third session, chipping away. We were intrigued by the chipping away of the Michelangelo metaphor in the last session. Let's see what chipping away might mean in this session, Barbara.
Thank you. Well, we continue to chip away, and we have an assemblage of things that we've suggested that forgiveness is not. And of course, some of them do fly in the face of the way you were raised or what you think. And you know, you don't have to believe what I say. You can just put that out there, and you can. We will all make up our own minds. I'm thinking of another aspect of forgiveness, but let's review the ones we have. We said that forgiveness is not forgetting. We said that it is not acquittal. It just has nothing to do with things being okay. We said that it does not erase consequences. It is not pardon. It doesn't erase history. We've said that although it might be regrettable, it may not restore presence. We've said that it is not primarily about the past, although it is occasioned by something that happened in the past, perhaps. But it is about the present and the future. Using the trinity of the human person, we have said that it is not primarily a feeling, that it is more a matter that is begun by the will and completed by the person, empowered by the Holy Spirit, empowered by God. So let's continue. We think also that forgiveness is primarily about the perpetrator. Is he forgivable or not? Can I forgive him or not? Is she forgivable? Can I forgive her? But I want to say that forgiveness is really not about the perpetrator. It is about me. It may be occasioned by something the perpetrator did, but I am the one who carries it. I am thinking of a situation in which someone was terribly focused upon a person who'd done a bad thing to her and could not let it go and became obsessed with that person and all of everything about him. Now this person was mentally ill and demonstrated this obsession in the context of her disease so that she had a paranoid delusion about the person and felt that he was following her, that he was able to send magical vibrations to her, that she was able to send poisonous gas to her, that he was able from a long distance to poison her food in the accents of her illness, of her delusion, which of course is extreme because she was ill. We see a version of ourselves, because you know, we may not be ill in that way, but we do that too. It seems that the thing that we are focused on, the person that we are focused on when we've been injured, we give that person more power than he or she really has. The person is huge in our imaginations, and when we turn and face the situation more accurately, he shrinks to a normal human size. Forgiveness is not as much about the perpetrator as it is about me. I am thinking of two ladies that I knew growing up. Mrs. Lee and Mrs. Day. They were, well, you have to understand these little tiny churches in the country in order to know who they were. But if you went to one of those churches, you already know who they are. They were the ladies who ran the church. They were the grand dame of the church. And Mrs. Lee was tall and statuesque and beautifully dressed, very assertive lady, Mrs. Lee. And beautifully dressed, she was a wonderful seamstress, and she made suits for herself that were just gorgeous and brilliantly colored. She was like a parrot. She was just beautiful. Hot pink and fuchsia and lime green and aqua blue. And she had purses and shoes that would match or contrast with them in a beautiful way. My mother and my grandmother had only black ones, black shoes for the winter and white ones for the summer. That was it. But Mrs. Lee was just resplendent. She was a peacock. And big hats. Back ladies all wore hats then. Great big beautiful hats. Also in amazing colors and gloves that went all the way up her sleeves. And she wore a fur, the kind with the heads on. Where they, the two couple minks chase each other around your shoulders. she was something to behold. She was something to behold. Mrs. Day was shorter and rounder, also beautifully dressed, also a wonderful seamstress. I still have an afghan that she made for my mother. And she didn't have the big hats. She would have looked like a mushroom in them because she was short, but she had lovely pillboxes, give her a little bit of height, turbans. She had some of those feather hats that the ladies used to wear, made of wall-to-wall feathers. She was also a wonder. They were the ladies who must be consulted in the church. Every year we had a couple of events. We had parish suppers that we would invite the whole county to. Oh, they were wonderful. They were wonderful. A chicken in the spring and roast turkey in the fall. You could smell us for miles. And everybody in the country, in the county came. And Mrs. Lee, she ran the kitchen like a general. She was tough. You did not volunteer to work in there. She would draft you to work in there. She'd tell you you could work in there. And people would work in there. Not girls like us. We were too young to do that. Not girls like us. We were too young to do that. But grown men, big men, they'd be working in there with her, and they would stir what she said to stir and mash what she said to mash and lift what she said to lift, and they were obedient to her because you just had to be. Mrs. Day, she ran the dining room, and we girls worked for Mrs. Day, and oh, we were fleet of foot, and we would run, and we would get the plates from the pass-through, through the parish hall window into the parish hall and set them in front of the diner. And oh, the diners were thrilled because it smelled so good. Mrs. Thompson was in the back, and she was in the back corner of the room, and she had two of those ovens that have lids that are electric, and she was rolling and baking biscuits right there in the dining room. She'd lift the lid off, and the smell would just about knock you out. It was so lovely. And we'd fill up a little basket with these biscuits and set them in front of the diners. They'd just about pass out. They were so good. Smelled so good. And over along there, that was the pie table. And there was all kinds of pies you could imagine. There was apple pie and peach pie and blueberry pie and strawberry rhubarb pie and plain rhubarb pie and French apple pie and pineapple custard pie and pumpkin pie and pecan pie and chocolate pie and lemon meringue pie and lemon chiffon pie and butterscotch pie and every kind of pie you could imagine. And we would cut these pies into sixths, not into eighths. We were not stingy like that, no. Everybody got a sixth of the pie. We'd load up a tray and we'd make the diners choose. If they needed another piece of pie after that, they could go and they could buy one at the fancy work table right across from the bake table. They could get these things at the bake table. And then at the fancy work table, there was sock monkeys you could buy made out of men's socks. You could buy potholders that the girls had made on those looms that you make. You could buy aprons, half aprons that tied around your waist. You could buy a doll that you could set on your bed with a great big wide plastic skirt. in some garish color, or you could buy another doll that would have a smaller skirt and she would sit on your toilet paper roll and conceal those from the curious in your bathroom. Oh, and there were bunnies made out of a bar of soap folded around a washcloth, and mittens on a tree, so many things that you could buy. Oh, what an event it was. We would make, and this is in the 1950s, $400 at these, and that's a lot of money back then. Mm-hmm. For a little outfit, tiny church, we were 40 people if we were all there, so it wasn't a lot of people, and it was a big event, very successful event, led by these two ladies. Mm-hmm. Amazing that a small group of people could do this. All the more amazing when you reflect that the two principals, the two leaders, did not speak. Had not spoken to each other in years. I wanted to know why, but my grandmother and my mother wouldn't tell me why. The other person who wanted to know why was the minister. He wanted to know too. He thought, you know, if two leaders in my church aren't speaking to each other, I want to know. Why? I should know, I'm the pastor, but people in the country aren't just always forthcoming. He'd only been there for 5 years or so. Why do we have to tell him everything of our business right off the bat like that? He didn't even have time for him to know, he'll know. So they didn't like that. Late at night, he was single. He was working on his sermon late one night, Saturday night. And his eyes fell on the Book of Common Prayer, a rubric concerning the celebration of the Holy Eucharist. And it said, if a member of the congregation is living a notoriously sinful life, which none of us were. We didn't have any opportunity to do that. We had a couple people who did that more or less on behalf of all the rest of us in town, so we didn't have to bother. Living a notoriously sinful life or estranged one from another. The minister could, after having counseled them to reconcile, exclude them from communion until such time as they did. Now, he was young, perhaps did not know the full limits of his power yet. And so he spoke to those two ladies, and he told them that if they had not spoken by the following week, that they would not be admitted to communion. Well, everybody was in church the next week. It was like it was like Easter or Christmas. My mother and my grandmother were both there, which usually was not the case. One of them would go to the 8 and then come home and cook, while the other one went to the 11, so that when we got home, there would be some wonderful food. That's the way we were spoiled. I don't know what we had for lunch that day. I don't even know if we even ate lunch that day. They had bigger fish to fry than our lunch that day. We got there, sitting there. Mrs. Lee, of course, was already there. I caught sight of one of the minks looking at me. And I looked away. She was sitting there like a queen she was, greeting everybody, and then Mrs. Day comes in. And standing right next to Mrs. Lee, who had an aisle seat, looking straight ahead at the altar of God, she said, "Good morning, Mrs. Lee." And Mrs. Lee said, "Good morning, Mrs. Day." And she went back up to her seat, and that was it. Minister's listening. It wasn't what he'd hoped. But they'd spoken, and so he gave the signal to the organist, and she swooped into the first hymn, and life went out. I'm not sure they ever spoke again after that. But they had spoken. They're both dead, been dead for many years, so I reckon they're speaking now. And I was all grown up before I realized why. And I will tell you now that all the people are dead. They'd grown up in the little church, same way I grew up, same school, same everything. And Mrs. Day became pregnant out of wedlock. And in an arrangement that might seem odd to us, but was not entirely unheard of then, she and her mother sort of disappeared. And when they emerged, her mother had a new baby. And the baby grew to adulthood not knowing that the lady she thought was her mother was really her grandma. Mm. And the lady she thought was her big sister was really her mother. Mm-hmm. Well, Mrs. Lee, who wasn't Mrs. Lee yet, she said something mean about it to somebody. And of course it got right back to Mrs. Day because it was a tiny town, and of course it hit her right in her shame. And that was the beginning of the freeze. You know, Mrs. Lee should have said, I'm sorry, I don't know what got into me, I shouldn't have said that. But that was not the way she was even then. And Mrs. Day should have said, what are you doing talking about me like that behind my back? But she couldn't because she was ashamed. And so they didn't speak all those years. They were good ladies, they were good women. But it would have been better if they could have spoken. Mm. It would be better if they didn't have to go all that time like that. That's why it matters that we don't take a person and make any part of our life all about him or her. That we take to ourselves the responsibility that we have to live in community fully, knowing that there's going to be ups and downs and there's going to be disagreements and there is going to be hurts, but there needs to be conversation still. It's funny that, well, Mrs. Lee did something mean to Mrs. Day, and okay, that was true, she had offended against her, but then by holding it, in a way, although not ethically and not morally really, but effectively, the perpetrator and the victim are the same. If the perpetrator does the deed and you hold on to the deed, in a way, you help the perpetrator continue the deed. The perpetrator may have done it, but if you hold it, in effect, you become a co-conspirator with your own aggressor. not in a matter of guilt. No. The guilt is still his, but the effect, if you carry it, becomes yours. So there is a perverse identity between perpetrator and victim. I think about this a lot. Because we define ourselves so much as we are the ones against so-and-so. We're the ones who must disagree with our enemy. In politics, it's always that. Well, I'm against whatever he's for, that's all. And it becomes a substitute for thinking for us. I don't have to think about an issue, I just have to know who's for it, then I know to be against it. That ought not to be good enough for us. We need to define ourselves as ourselves and not allow our enemy to define us. Forgiveness then can't be for me just about my perpetrator. It's about me. In a sense, forgiveness is not really this wonderful thing I'm going to do to welcome my perpetrator back into my world. Forgiveness in a way is an act of self-love, an act selfish. I don't want to say selfish because that suggests small-minded and it's large-minded, but that it is a gift to myself. It is a primarily for me that I need to forgive. It's something I need. My perpetrator, the one who hurt me, he may be dead. It may not affect him at all. He may never know about it. But I know, and maybe I'm the one who needs to be free. How free do you want to be? Do you want freedom enough to turn your focus from the one who has hurt you to yourself so that you and you alone can take the action you need to get out of jail? A jail that he may have built for you, but a jail whose door you continue to keep locked.
I don't know about you folks, but I love good storytelling. Don't you just, and I just so value that, Barbara, you chose to use that mode of teaching with
you
us.
You know those ladies, right? No matter where you're from, you know those ladies.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So where does Barbara's story and this reflection about the perpetrator and our participation in the process, where does that lead you in your reflection? Are there questions that you want to pursue with Barbara or conversation with one another? Let's see where we go with this now.
I really appreciated when you mentioned the prison, choosing to release mm-hmm. yourself from that prison. I'm not too sure who said this quote, but there's a quote that says, forgiveness is releasing a prisoner mm-hmm. and then discovering that prisoner was you. Mm-hmm. And I think that is so powerful because we are agents of change and we have our destinies in our hands. And every time I listen to you speak on forgiveness or I'm hearing the stories, those two women, Miss Day and Miss Lee, both had, well, they felt there was almost an ultimatum, but they made the choice to take responsibility for their actions again. Mm-hmm. And I think that's important when it comes to our lives, to decide to choose whether or not we will continue to allow someone to hurt us perpetually, or we would choose to move on and release that hurt and step into the future by faith.
And how big it becomes, you know, if they'd done it at the beginning, it would have been an afternoon's work, mm-hmm. if that. Mm-hmm. And because they didn't, and because it lasted so long, it became so large, and a whole community, a small one, kind of built themselves around it. You know, we managed all right, we did well, but it would have been better if we hadn't had that. Look at what happens nationally when this is extrapolated onto a group and how people die from it, lots of them, mm-hmm. die from our identification of an enemy as the evil and our inability to see our own role in perpetuating an arms race. Mm-hmm. You know, you did this to me, so I'm going to do this to you, so then you're going to do this to me, and I'll do this to you, and we'll be back and forth with each other. And that, I think, has never, wars have never brought peace. Nonviolence has brought peace. I'm thinking of South Africa. Mm-hmm. There was plenty of violence leading up to it, but what brought the peace mm-hmm. was nonviolence. Mm-hmm. And India, yeah. the independence of India, mm-hmm. there was certainly violence leading up to it, but what brought it? Was nonviolent resistance. The willingness to say, yes, so-and-so has done this to me, and it was bad, but I am not going to play. I'm not going to do it back. I'm going to stand and resist, and I'm going to be immovable. You don't have to not resist, but you just stand. And what you don't do is shoot back. And what has, and you know, here we are in the shadow of the World Trade Center again. That we chose to make this a war, our response, involved us in joining the perpetrator, not morally and not legally, but in the effect. We have participated in a war and we have become makers of war. When you participate in a war, you become a maker of war. It doesn't bring peace. We think it will, but it does not. Many have said that the world is, you know, should be safer now. I think it's more dangerous now. Mm-hmm. Because that we chose to make it a war instead of some other action that might have been met with a different response. Mm-hmm. And that's, an individual can choose to make it a war. Mrs. Lee and Mrs. Day made it a war. And it didn't have to be a war. It could have just been a battle. And they could have just said, oh, all right, and had done with it. And they didn't. They made it a war.
The community part, when you brought that up, really spoke to me, as well as the individual. So here you have these two things that seem opposite. But as an individual in a church setting, you're really part of a community. Mm-hmm. Or in the world, you're part of a community. Mm. And it's when there is conflict or difficulties between two people, it really is impacting the community. And it's the delicate thing of where does the community, how does the community involve itself? What does the community do? Do we take those steps, the same steps we talk about as individuals, about forgiveness? Are we responsible for you know, this instance where there needs to be
like
forgiveness?
Like the Amish families. Remember when they went and the man who had killed all their children, and they went and, because Ralph, you brought him up, I think, that they knew of, they absolutely had been raised thinking of forgiveness, so they knew that that was what they had to do because it was how they were raised. But they did it the next day. They could not be who they were unless they did this. They were injured as a community horribly by the loss of their children, but they could not allow themselves to be further injured by not being who they were. Because then they would have lost everything. I not only lost my child, I've now lost myself because I can't do what all of my upbringing has been about doing. And we know that the Amish, those parents, they didn't have, you know, good feelings about the man, and they didn't think it was okay what he did, and they didn't think, you know, none of those things that we've said forgiveness is not were in their minds. But they knew that they had to go, and so they went. Their healing from this, their forgiveness, it's still going on. They made the step, and off they walked down the road, and off they went. And so they were responsible, though not to blame, but they took their responsibility and they did it, and nobody else could have done it. They had to do that. They had each other. And they had the teaching of their community to help them do that. And the world looked at it and was amazed.
It seems like a lot of Jesus' initiatives were to bring people back into community. I mean, that's really very striking to me, and I like that aspect of his relating to community, relating to individuals, bring them back into, because there was so much in their society that was about driving people, making judgment, driving them out of community. And it was always to bring them back, re-identifying in their community, or creating a new community that hadn't been imagined before.
Well, I think that's helpful, because I was, you know, I wonder if Jesus' most important gift at the point of his resurrection with the disciples when he breathed on them. And it's always struck me as fascinating that what he says is that you have the power to forgive or to not forgive. And it's like a choice, you know, but I mean, this is like a peak of our story, I think, and one to take with us, that somehow we can create community, you know, through this power to forgive. But I think there's an implication that we may not, and maybe we're free almost not to. There's almost a great responsibility there of how are you going to use this power that did not exist before.
So I'm thinking, just as you said, as you were speaking, he says, if you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you do. If you welcome that person back into your community he's in, it arises from within you. It arises from within you. So it's not that you have a ticket and he's forgiven and therefore God loves him. God already loves him. If you forgive him, he is forgiven and he is enclosed again in the circle of who you are. That's a statement not about admission into heaven. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. But a statement about the inclusion, the admission into the community, the re-welcoming into the community. Mm. And I've never thought of it like that until I was just hearing you talk. Because we think you have the keys to forgiveness, and if one of the apostles forgives you, then you get to go to heaven. Mm. And if he doesn't, too bad for you. But I don't think it's about that. Mm-hmm. I think it's actually about the community. If we forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven, and that means they are with us again. They are back. We know that the apostles sometimes, people left and people were at odds and left and didn't come back, and all kinds of things happened. But the community had the power to create itself out of the grace of forgiveness. Mm-hmm. That's really beautiful.
And this happened a few years back, and I was amazed by how the public reacted to this story. There was a woman who lost her son. He was doing some type of good work. I think he picked up another young man who was on the street, and so he gave him a free pass, and he drove him to where he needed to go, and after getting out of the car, he shot the young son who was doing a good thing, and they arrested the murderer, and he was being tried, and there was that moment where the mother of the murdered son came together with the murderer, and there was that intensity in that moment, what's going to happen, and the murderer starts to cry, and people looked at the mother. They were wondering, what is she going to do? And she just reached over and held him. And people asked, how could you do that? How could you hold this murderer? She said, if my son were in that case, I would want someone to hold him. Mm-hmm. And I think it's that familiarity, mm-hmm. you know, finding yourself in the other person, that you make that connection, that real forgiveness.
Yeah.
Let's stop there. Ryan, it's a lovely place to stop, you know, another story. And Barbara's enriched our time together with story, and so we'll just bring it to a close. There is so much more to be explored, and it just seems like we're getting warmed up here, folks, and that may be true for you too. We're actually going to break for lunch now. This is our day together, and so there's so much amazing material here. And I just hope that you are finding it as rich and as such a blessing as we are. And we'll be back on the other side of lunch for session 4. And meanwhile, over to you. Blessings as you go.